Welcome everybody to Algebra 2. Today we've got section 4b.5, analyzing graphs of polynomial functions. Now this, just a little bit of a heads up, this lesson does require the use of a graphing calculator. I'll be using a TI-84. We're going to explore some of the tools that help us find key points in polynomial functions, and these will not come out cleanly. This is a way for us to kind of explore some of the neater features of a graphing calculator. So if you have one with you, I would get that out so you can practice along. And let's get to it. How do we analyze the graph of a polynomial? So one of the things that we've noticed about our polynomial functions is that they have bends in them. And we've kind of seen some patterns that show that, for instance, this first function is an x to the third. You can see it bends twice. And that's a quality that we've kind of picked up along the way. Secondly, we've got an x to the fourth, a fourth degree polynomial. You can see it bends once, and then a second time, and then a third time. But here we've got a fifth degree polynomial, and it really only appears to bend twice. So what we've said is that a polynomial of degree n has at most n minus 1 turns. So a third degree polynomial, at most, it's going to bend twice. And again, each time I say bend, I'm referring to a turning point. So you can think of that as being a bend in the graph. And we describe that as a turning point because it switches from increasing to decreasing. So if we look at our first example here, you can see our function, if I'm reading it from left to right, we have an increasing portion, then it peaks out right here. That's a turning point, a maximum. Then that graph turns to be decreasing for a while until it reaches this valley or a minimum point. That's another turning point. We switch to increasing again. So knowing what those peaks and valleys are, those places where the graph turns, really helps us analyze where that function is sloping up, increasing, or sloping down, decreasing. All right, so our task here is just to approximate what these turning point coordinates are. So if I'm looking at this first graph and I'm trying to figure out that first turn in the graph where I first saw it bend, switch from increasing to decreasing, you can see our units are counting by ones. I would say that's like negative, 0.2. And let's see, I kind of got in the way of my tick marks here, maybe close to one. And then that second turning point where we switched from decreasing to increasing, I would say that's positive 1.2 and negative 1.6. I don't know. These are approximations. They just want us to be able to estimate where we feel that those are happening. For the second graph here, we start off decreasing as we read from left to right, and we reach this first turning point, this first bend in the graph down here. That looks like it's the point, negative 1.1. negative 5.9, almost negative 6. At that point, the graph switches from decreasing, increases for a while until it reaches this turning point, which I would say is, 0.2 and negative 0.8. And these are just estimates, right? Then our graph decreases for just a heartbeat right here to what looks like the point negative 1. And after going through that turning point, the graph is increasing, but we don't see any more turns. So those three turning points happened in our fourth degree polynomial, and that's the most we could see, right? Three turns in a fourth degree. Now let's look at our last example here, our fifth degree polynomial. The function begins by decreasing, and then it has a turning point right here. Looks like the point negative 1. After reaching that turning point, the graph then increases till we reach this point here, which looks to be about, I'd say 0.8 and 5.6 maybe. And after going through that turning point, the graph decreases the rest of the way. There's no more bends in the graph. Now, sometimes it's tempting to think with rules and math and patterns that we see that they are ironclad. And so, this is a fifth degree polynomial. I should have four turning points. No, it's at most four. So at most, it could bend one less time than we see in the degree. So here, the fact that it's only two, that's just fine. At the most, it could have had four, but it could have fewer. right? Those end up being really big. Sorry, just to go back for a second. These end up being really big concepts in early calculus that you do. The first, I don't know, third of calculus is pretty much devoted to finding out where functions are increasing and decreasing. So those turning points end up being pretty critical things to know about. All right, so our key concepts for this section. First of all, connecting some of the vocabulary we've seen. If we have some polynomial function, a zero is a number. A factor is, we usually see these in parentheses, the linear factor of that polynomial. So if a zero is k, the factor x minus k produces that zero. A solution is what we have when we start off with a equation, like a function set equal to zero. So a solution or a root, but we're still talking about that number k. And then the x-intercept is still using that solution k, except now it's an ordered pair. It's a point on the coordinate plane. So you'll notice all these things that we've kind of been using synonymously so far, they really are talking about the same place on a certain function. It's just different terminology kind of describes how we're going to see that. And the main thing we want to tell is the difference. Zeros and solutions are pretty much synonymous. It's just the number. So if we said find the zeros of the function, that means we would set the function equal to zero. So those are tied very closely together. The factor is just what factor produces that zero, so x minus the zero, and then the x-intercept is an ordered pair. So just slight variations on the same thing. Okay, and then lastly, the location principle. With our technology, we're going to see today that the TI-84 can really pinpoint places very, very accurately. But before then, if we had a table of values, and we have some input A and some input B in a function, and they have opposite signs. So for instance, if f of A is negative 2 and then f of B is positive 4, we know that somewhere between A and B, those inputs, we had to pass through 0 to go from negative 2 up to positive 4. We had to cross over from the negatives to positives, so we know that there would be a 0 between A and B. Okay, but again, the technology makes it possible for us to do this much more accurately. All right, so the turning points, as we explored in our introduction, we see that these are also referred to as a local maximum, or like a small peak in the graph, local minimum, a valley in the graph. It's where we switch from increasing to decreasing or vice versa. That's why we call it turning. Okay, and then that pattern we discussed, a polynomial of degree n has at most n minus 1 turning points, but it could have fewer. All right. Okay, and then just remember that the word decreasing, when we're talking about a function, it means sloping down to the right. So we see some type of behavior in our graph like that. And when a function is increasing, that just means some region of the graph that is sloping up to the right. Okay, and a good analogy here is to think of a businessman, right, giving some presentation to a board of directors or something, and imagine that they have like their sales charted here. How many clip art images have you seen of things like that? So if this represents the sales, these are bad areas, right, where the graph is going down to the right. Those are decreasing sales because they're sloping down to the right. However, these areas here would be good, right? The graph is increasing there. We're increasing sales. It's sloping up to the right. So if we kind of think of it that way, it may help. All right, so here kind of an extension of what our introduction was at the start of the lesson. We are going to look at a graph and try to estimate the coordinates of each turning point and identify each as a local max or min. Then estimate the real zeros and find the least possible degree of the function. Okay, so here you can see, as if I'm reading it from left to right, just like that sales pitch, here we are increasing until we get to this first turning point. So I'm going to jot that down. It looks like it was negative 1.2 maybe. And our y-axis, look at that label, we're counting by tens, so maybe 1.24. And that would be a local max. Then the graph turns and decreases for a while until we get to this point right here, which looks to be about 0.2. Now let's see, negative 10, negative 20, negative 30, negative 40, negative 50, so maybe negative 48. And that is a local min because it's a valley point in the graph. It's decreased down to that point. Then it turns and starts increasing again until I get to this turning point, this peak in the graph. That looks like 2.8. Again, we're just estimating here another local max. All right, then our graph decreases for a bit until we get to this, which looks to be about, 2.8. I keep using 0.8s, but that just looks right to me. And then maybe negative 3, another local min. Next, our estimated zeros in the graph. We'll do those in orange here. I've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 zeros. And those zeros are at, let's see, x equals, I'm going to go ahead and show these in set notation. You don't have to do this. We could just list them out. Remember, zeros are just numbers. It looks like I'm at about negative 1.5, negative 1, at positive 1.5, positive 2.5, and positive 3. Again, those are just places where the graph crosses the x-axis, just like we've been doing for a while now. All right, and the least possible degree. If I have 4 turning points, that means my graph has to be at least 5th degree. Right, if I have n minus 1 turning points, then n would have to be 5, right? 1 higher than how many turning points I have. And since I have 5 real zeros, that kind of corresponds with our fundamental theorem of algebra. A 5th degree could do this. Okay, so 5th degree polynomial. Right? And it could be higher than that, but at the very least, because of the 4 turning points, because of the 5 zeros, the lowest it could be is a 5th degree polynomial. All right. Now, the remaining 3 examples emphasize the technology usage. How can the calculator help us with this? And so just before we dive into this, I'm just going to see if my arrow get a little bit more space there. We're going to jot down a couple notes here. Calc 0, calc max, calc min. What did we just see in our last example that helped us deal with these polynomial functions, analyze them a little bit, finding the zeros, finding the local maximums, and finding the local minimums? Your calculator has a menu called the calc menu that has abilities to scan a graph for zeros, maximums, and minimums. All right, so what we're going to do for the last 3 examples of this lesson is we're going to actually do our homework together. If I'm going to have you do examples, I might as well count for something, right? So I've just copied those into this lesson right now. But you can see it says worksheet problem 1. I've just chosen a couple of those off your worksheet to do for our examples together. So we're going to graph the function, identify the x-intercepts, and then we're going to decide where it's increasing and where it's decreasing. And you can see I've left the x and y axes very, very bare. I want you to be able to scale this and sketch this as you see fit. So let's see. I'm going to pull up my calculator really quickly. And in that calculator, I'm going to turn it on first. That helps clear out any of that little scratch work. We'll go to the y equals menu. And that's where we'll type in our function. So again, y equals right there. We've got x to the third power. I've got to hit the right arrow key to bump out of that exponent. Minus 2x squared. Variable key right there to put the x's. A lot of you are familiar with this already. Minus 3. And we use this last in our section 4.3. Now we actually kind of want to see the graph. So I'm going to hit graph and make sure I see everything okay. And it looks like I'm seeing a pretty good picture, but notice my x-axis, I must have changed that or something must have happened because usually it goes from negative 10 to 10 and I'm just not seeing that many tick marks. If your window ever looks weird, the zoom key right here in the middle in the top, if you hit that and then zoom 6, so I'm just going to hit the number 6, that will take you back to a standard 10 by 10 window. And for our purposes here today, this will be the best one. So you'll notice I only have one real zero. It's right here, and it looks like it's approximately 2 point something. So I want to find that zero first of all. That's a point that I can plot over here on my graph. So to get to that calculate menu, you can see it's just above the trace key. It says calc in blue. So I'm going to hit second trace to bring up that calculate menu. And I want to calculate a zero. So I'm going to go down to option 2 and hit enter. And it asks me for a left bound. Basically, what the calculator wants is it wants me to set some place to the left and some place to the right where my zero is in between, kind of like that location principle. And so it will read from left to right in between whatever two values I choose. Now, you can use the arrow keys to kind of move the cursor and then hit enter to lock in the left and the right. But I like to just type it in. It'll let you type in an X value. So I'm going to type in between 1 and 4. So my left bound, start scanning when X is 1. You see it puts a little arrow there saying, hey, I'm going to start scanning here. And my right bound is going to be when X equals 4. All right, so those little arrows show me where the calculator is going to be scanning in between left and right. And you can see my zero is in between those arrows. That's good. It asks for a guess, but I don't want a guess. I just want the answer. So I'm just going to hit enter again. And there we go. It's 2.49. All right, so over here on the screen here, I guess I should close that thing out. The only zero I had was 2.490. Now, this time the y value came out as a nice clean zero. Sometimes it will give you scientific notation like 2.89 e to the negative 17. That's just the calculator rounding to zero. So this one came out nice and clean, but just be aware that may not always happen. So there is a zero I got. All right, let's pull up the calculator again. And I still have my graph in place. I'm going to go second trace again. This time, let's look for a maximum point. You can see my graph has a max right here. And again, it's looking for some place to scan. It's looking for a left bound and a right bound. So I'm going to do x equals negative 2 to start scanning. And I'm going to choose positive 1 for it to stop scanning. Whoops. All right, it asks for a guess. I don't want to guess, so I just hit enter again. So here's an example of that calculator rounding. It says 1.407 e to the negative 6. That's just as close as it can get to 0. So the point 0, negative 3 is that minimum point. All right, so we'll do that in blue. 0, negative 3. All right, now let's go back to our graph and look for a maximum. Second trace, option 4, and you can just hit the number 4 to go right to finding a maximum. Wait, we already found the maximum. Option 3, let's look for the minimum now. So left bound, right bound, here's my minimum point right about there. If I go from x equals 0 to x equals 4, so 0 for the left, 4 for the right, and just hit enter to go through the guess, I get 1.333333. Okay, so my minimum is 1.33 for our purposes here. We're going to go ahead and round a little bit. we'll use light blue for that. And what was the Y value? Negative 4.19. So 1.33, negative 4.19, be right about there. And using those values, I can get a nice sketch for the graph. I know that that was a maximum, that was a minimum. I passed through that zero. There's my graph just using those key points. And now let's do the increasing and decreasing intervals. So I was increasing everywhere from the left up until I got to that x equals zero. So I was increasing over here, that's all these x values. So when x is less than zero, I was increasing. Then it decreased for a while. And once I hit that light blue turning point, I was increasing the rest of the way. So for all x values that were greater than that 1.33, we were increasing. For the decreasing, that's this part of the graph. That's between this dark blue and light blue point. That's between this dark blue and light blue x value. So 0 is less than x is less than 1.33. Knowing how to use calc max, calc min, and calc 0 is such a huge, huge benefit. Just because really messy things like trying to find the 0 of quadratics. Remember doing quadratic formula and all the algebra simplifying? To know that the calculator can find that 0 is pretty helpful. Finding the vertex, that's just doing calc min or calc max. It really does give us a really nice check. All right, so there's one of our problems done. You can see no work on our part other than just knowing how to navigate the calculator. All right, so here's this next one. Go ahead and pull up the calculator again. New problem, I'm going to go back to y equals, and let's just edit this one. So this time I've got negative x to the third. Let's go ahead and clear out that one. Negative x to the third, get out of the exponent there. Minus x to the second plus x plus 4. Enter that function. Let's look at the graph. All right, and just as with the last one, I think it's a good idea to start with the 0. But really, if you find the max and the min and the 0 and plot those points, your calculator's graph will kind of tell you how to fill in everything in between. Connect the dots, so to speak. I like to find the zeros first. It's me, so we'll go second trace. Let's choose 0. My 0 is right about here, so I'm going to say between x equals 0 and x equals 3. For my left bound and right bound, 0 and 3. I don't want to guess, so I'm just going to hit enter. A lot of students forget to hit enter that last time. We don't want to stop until it actually tells us 0 and gives us some coordinates. So I got 1.49 for this one. So let's see. And we're rounding to two decimal places. You could be more accurate if you would like. But two decimal places is pretty sufficient. Next, for a maximum, enter for calc max. You can see that's happening somewhere over here. It looks like it might be just a touch past our y-axis. So for my left bound, I'm going to choose x being negative 1. For my right bound, I'm going to choose x equaling positive 1. And I don't want to guess. It would give me the answer there. And so the maximum is 0.33333334.19. Try and keep the colors the same. 0.33333334.19. So about right here was our maximum point. Next, we'll find our minimum. And that appears to be right over here around x equals negative 1. So my left bound, I'm going to start at x equaling negative 2. Start your scanning there, TI-84, and we will stop when x equals 0. Don't want to guess. I just want the answer. Let's go. -0.9999977. So this actually rounds to a negative 1. So negative 1, 3. Right there. And we can kind of fill in the pieces our calculator's telling us, but we also have nice little rules of end behavior, right? I know it's a negative odd, so it rises to the left and falls to the right. We've learned so many things, it's kind of cool to see them all come together. Where's that graph increasing? Well, the only place I see it going up to the right is in between the light blue and the dark blue. So between the light blue and the dark blue, that's when x is between negative 1 and 0.33. And it's decreasing when I'm way over here off to the left. Okay, so that's when my x's are less than negative 1, right? Less than my minimum. It had to decrease down, fall until to the valley at the very end. And then once I get past that dark blue point, in other words, when my x is greater than 0.33, the graph is sloping down yet again. All right, so there you have it. I know it says graph the function right away. A lot of times students will think that they have to draw the graph really, really detailed early on. But you'll notice when we find these key points, we can actually sketch the graph as we go along. It may save a little bit of time along the way. Encourage you to do that. And our final example, here we have a quartic function, fourth degree. It's negative and fourth degree, which means I know the ends are going to be falling left and right. I know there could be three bends in that graph, so maybe an M looking thing. I'm really not sure, but I'm just kind of trying to visualize what I can expect to see here. All right, so let's turn to our calculator and see what this creature looks like. Y equals, clear out what's there, negative x to the fourth, leave that exponent, minus x to the third, leave that exponent, plus 4x to the second, minus 1. And we'll hit graph. Ooh, okay, so kind of a wonky looking M shape. Okay, but as you can see, we do have three turns in the graph. That's the most we could see in a fourth degree polynomial. We have 1, 2, 3, 4 zeros happening here, which again, we can expect to see. Four real zeros is possible in a fourth degree polynomial. We just got some stuff to find here. So this is going to be a little bit of an endeavor. Let's find our first zero. First zero happens over here. So I'm going to say that's from x equals negative 5 to negative 2. Start scanning at negative 5. Okay, that was a little bit excessive. Stop scanning at negative 2. Just a quick check. Ooh, I'm kind of cutting it close there, but I think that'll pick up this 0. Let's hit enter one last time. Yep, it picked it up. Negative 2.52. Oh, and here you can see the y value. Remember, this is the calculator rounding. That scientific notation means it's pretty darn close to 0. So negative 2.52. And remember, there were four zeros here, so I'm writing really skinny here, so I know I can fit everything on that little line. Calculate, find a next zero. It looks like it's right here, somewhere between negative 2 and 0. So negative 2 to 0. Enter through the guess. Negative 0.49. I've been seeing a lot of 49s, it seems like. There's our second zero. And technically, I've been writing these out as ordered pairs. That's just because I'm plotting the points as well. But because this is using the terminology zero, I could just list out negative 2.52, comma, negative 0.49, comma. I don't need to list the whole ordered pair. I just kind of caught that just now. All right, the next one seems to be right here. Let's see what happens for our left bound, right bound. I'm going to start at x equals 0, stop at x equals 1. And if I enter through the guess, sure enough, that's 0.57. Okay, so again, I'm listing out all these x-intercepts. You don't need to list out the entire ordered pair. And our last one, that seems to be between x equals 1 and x equals 2. There it is, it found it. And you can kind of see the cursor is showing me if I actually found that spot on the graph or not. So I sure enough I did. It's 1.44. Okay. All right, so let's see, I gotta go out to negative 3. There's about negative 2.52. There's about negative 0.49. There's about positive 0.57. There's about positive 1.44. Now let's take a look at our graph again. It's time to find a maximum. Oh, and we've got two of them. All right, so let's go second calculate. Maximum is 4. If I look out here, it looks like somewhere between x being negative 4 and 0. So negative 4 and 0. Don't want to guess. Hey there, it found the peak. It's at negative 1.84 and 7.31. All right, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So negative 1.84 about and 7.31 puts me about right there for that maximum. And if you remember our graph, we do have another one. So let's find that one next. This one appears to be between x equals 0 and x equals 2. So left bound of 0, right bound of 2. Calculator will scan between there. I'll hit enter. Don't even bother guessing. So we got 1.09 and 1.05. So 1.09, 1.05. There is our other maximum point. And our graph did have one minimum, which it looks like it's 0, negative 1. Just a hunch. But if I have the calculator, I might as well check with it. So I'm going to go from x being negative 1 to x being positive 1. My guess, I'm just going to hit enter. All right, so again, there's scientific notation. This is the calculator saying, hey, this is really 0. I just couldn't get it to come out cleanly. So it's, if we round that, it is 0. And then negative 1. So 0, negative 1 is correct. Okay. There's that. All right, so let's see. Our graph, if I connect those points together. Sorry, I'm trying to draw on a tablet here. It's not as nice as my smart board. But there, we had something that looked like that on our calculator. That's actually not too bad. I am increasing up to this first maximum and up to this second maximum. So off on the far left, that's all x values that are less than negative 1.84. And then also between the light blue and the dark blue point, I was sloping up there. The light blue had an x value of 0. The next dark blue point had an x value of 1.09, so if my x's are in between those, that describes this sloping up portion of the graph. And our decreasing, well, I went from this maximum, I dropped all the way down to the minimum, so that was when my x's were between negative 1.84 and 0. And then after I get past that second maximum, that second dark blue point at 1.09, the graph is decreasing, sloping downward after that. So that describes where the graph is decreasing. Now, these are things that we've all had experience with throughout chapters 2 and 3 and 4. so far, but it's just really cool to see how technology can take a lot of that algebra out of the way. And when you get to calculus, you'll be able to answer this a lot more accurately. But it's really cool to be able to share some calculator skills with you today. And you get three of your homework problems done with a little bit of guided practice. So I hope you found this to be an informative lesson. I know we kind of took our time, but if we really understand those menus on the calculator, I really hope you understand how much of a help that's going to be, not just in this class, but the rest of the way out. Calc 0, Calc Max, Calc Min, they do a heck of a lot for you. So thanks for watching, and good luck with your homework.